Hey.
Hello.
Who are you? Hope everyone is alive, right? Still alive, yeah. That's good. Okay. My name is Sohail, and so here we are going to talk about today notifications. By the way, who all uses notification in the app? Few of them? Yeah, good. Who uses remote notifications? Push notification which is coming from the backend.
Right. Yes.
From the backend, not from the within the app.
Okay.
Notifications, as we all know, is one of the best tools for marketing. By fact, it increases the engagement of the app by 80%. 80% additional engagement, and it is one of the very powerful tools for keeping the users using the app. Like one of the study was found that people who have activated the notifications, they open app at an average of 14 times in a month, compared to the people who do not have activated the notification, they open 5 times that particular app in a month. So it is helpful, very helpful. Now, there are two types of notification. One which is within your app, when something task happen and you send a notification. The other one is the remote notification, which is which you push from your server. So let's see this, how that. In general, the notifications are not cross-platform. So every platform, they have their own way of their own implementation of, so like Google have their own cloud messaging service, Apple has their own Apple push notification service, and the way it works is that firstly you have to register the device ID, so whenever the device comes up, they have to connect to the platform specific service. Let's say Google's if it is Android, it has to connect to the Google's cloud messaging service and register the device, so that the Google's cloud messaging service will know that this particular device has this IP address, and then later when they want to push a notification, they will know where to push it. So the first step is that from the device, you register to the notification service and get back the device ID and save that device ID somewhere in your backend. And whenever you want to then later push the notification, you send that ID to the push notification service, and then it will send that to the device. So this is how normally it works. So in case of Google, now they change the name. So now the new console, Firebase. So it's called Firebase Cloud Messaging. And then it will, so from your backend, it will push it to generally to Firebase Cloud Messaging for Android, and it will push it to Android. And in case of iOS, it will push it to Apple Push Notification Service, and then it will forward it to the iOS device. But the problem in this is that you have to do it separately for each platform. So you have to do it, your interface would be different for different platforms. So if you have three platforms, your interface would be three different interface and three different codes for doing that. How we can simplify that is using Azure Notification Hub. So Azure Notification, so your backend would only push to Azure Notification Hub. You will set up, we'll need to do the setup, which I will go through how to set up that. But once you have set up the Azure Notification Hub with your Firebase Cloud Messaging and Azure Push Notification Service, your backend has just to push the notification to Azure, and Azure will push it to the relevant, whatever the platform it is. The way it works is this way. So the same thing, the Notification Hub has been added here. So first you register your device with the notification service, and get back the device ID, somehow then send that device ID to store it in your backend, and whenever you want to use you want to send a notification to that user or device,
you send that device ID to the notification hub, and it will forward it
to its respective user or device. So this is what we saw. Now, few scenarios when this can be helpful. I mean, these are some of them, but not limited to. One is maybe, let's say, location-based service. An example of this would be TripAdvisor. So if you have TripAdvisor app installed on your system, and you would have seen if you are near some famous location, it gives you notification that do you want to look around the food restaurants around this. If I'm in Sentosa, it will come up and say that there are great places around Sentosa. Do you want to take a look? So location-based services. Promotion content. If you have Foodpanda like me installed on your phone, which is one of my key app, they send push notification like 20% off or something like that, so that you keep on using their services. So promotion content, send reminders. If there's something like Meetup, so if Meetup, some of the events date or time has been changed at the last minute, the location has been changed at the last moment, the Meetup app gives you the notification, sends you the notification. Multi-factor authentication, like Telegram, which I know does that. So whenever you go to desktop web Telegram interface, it sends you the code to actual mobile application of Telegram, and from there you have to enter that code. So these are few of the scenarios, but there can be limitless scenarios where you can use the push notification. But when to use Azure notification? Why to use Azure notification app? Firstly, it is cross-platform. So you don't need to create a different interface for each of the platform, not just for Android and iOS and Windows. It also supports Kindle, Baidu, those platforms as well. So you have common interface, no different, no repeated code, and device registration. So if you still need to do some platform-specific code, because it is notifications are not cross-platform, so you won't be able to use it from Xamarin Forms. But what you can do if you are using a Xamarin Form, you can simplify the registration process and use the dependency injection to just use to do the device registration from your form app. But you will still need to do a little bit of platform-specific code. But from the backend, you will have a common interface. Different delivery patterns. So Azure notification have different delivery patterns. So once you are registered with the users and their devices, you can select either you want to send a message to a either you want to send this push notification to a user, and if that user is on multiple devices, like for example my application, I'm using it on Android and iOS. Both are signed up for same user. If I say on Azure notification app, if I say that I want to send it to user, and if that user has three devices or four devices, it will send to all of those devices. So you don't need to do that logic in your app or in your backend. Or you can say you want to send a notification to a specific device, and then it will send it to a specific device. You can schedule the notification. So right, if you do not want to send the notification right now, but you can send the notification in a scheduled way in Azure Notification Hub, and Azure Notification Hub will schedule that notification for you in the future, and then it will deliver to it. So there are different delivery patterns. You can personalize the push, so there are key pattern values which you can use to use the name of the users, like hey Sohail, you have not ordered food from 7 days, are you starving? So something like that. You can personalize it. Scalability, again, if your app is really doing well and you want to push your push notification, like for example, if you're using for messaging or So if your app has social components where there are a lot of messages coming for back and forth, or posts, comments, likes, so from a single person, from a single, just imagine, I mean, WhatsApp, how many notifications you receive per day in a WhatsApp, maybe like more than 100 notifications, right? So if your app has some kind of social component and one user is having 100 notifications per day on an average, and if you have maybe 100,000 users, that multiplies to easily 10 million notifications on an average. So if you have to send those notifications from your backend, you will need to do the architectural changes to make it to that scalable. But if you're using Azure Notification Hub, it is pretty easy to scale that level. So those are the few reasons why to use Azure Notification Hub. And I think, yeah, that's on the theory, but let's see how to do it actually. So I'm gonna straight away go to the Microsoft Azure portal, and we'll first try. What we need to first do is, let's see, this one. Okay. So first we need to configure the Azure Notification Hub, and then we need to configure the Firebase, and then our Android app, and then the Apple notification service, and then our iOS app. So this is what we'll do. So first, let's do the Azure part. So on Azure, you have to click New, and in web.mobile, there would be somewhere down there, yeah, Notification Hub. And I would give a Notification Hub name, maybe Notification Monkey, I don't know. Yeah, and I would create a new namespace with the same name. Yeah, location Southeast Asia. Yeah, and I would use my existing resources, or you can create new resource group. Pricing industries. So here you can see what I was saying about free pricing tier. So this is the free pricing tier. So even if you do not want to use the paid one, you will still get 1 million pushes. So 1 million notification per month you can send in a free tier. And even if you want 10 million, it is just $10 per month. So it's not that expensive. So I will select the free one and then create. And in some time it should create that. Okay, so deployment started. And then it should say it is done. So while the deployment is, while it is creating that notification hub, the next step is to create on Android. I believe it is. Okay, it is still done. So for Android, you need to go to console.firebase.google.com, and which is a new interface, by the way. And here you need to create a new project. This is for Android. And we need to give the name. I would give the same name. So Notification Monkey. And I will select Singapore. And this would create a new project as well. Let's come here and see, it is still deploying. Is the connection all right? Yeah, this connection is all right, this way. Okay, deployment succeeded, so that's good. Let's see that. Notification Monkey, okay. So this is a namespace, it's a notification hub. And let's see that. Okay, so it is created. Okay, our notification monkey is also there. Now here in project settings, cloud messaging, this is the stuff which we need. So there are two things, server key and sender ID. This we will be needed. So first thing I would do is to configure, let's go back to Azure. In Azure, I would see here notification services, and here are the platforms. So you see Apple, Google, Windows, Windows Phone, which was the earlier version, Amazon, and Baidu. So let's do first the Google. So we need to set up our Google notification, our Google app here, and it needs API key. So this is the API key, the server key, which we needed. So you just need to copy that and paste it and save. Okay, updated successfully. So from Azure, we have set up the push notification for our Google app. Now sender's ID will be used in our application, Android application. So let's go quickly and create one sample. I would close this solution and I will create a new project and Xamarin Forms app. Okay, and I will name it as same Notification Monkey, and yeah, I will name it like that. Desktop is easier to access. And this will create a new project, Xamarin Forms project. But since it is not related specifically to Xamarin Forms, we are going to use the Android and iOS application in particular. But it doesn't make any difference. You just have to do the one-time setup and then. Okay, while it is setting up, come back here and in access policies, if you click on access policies, there are two connection strings here for the notification hub. One is the permission is only listen, and the other one is listen, manage, and send. Listen is the permission which you would be using in your app, where you only need to listen to the certain notifications. Listen, manage, and send would be used in your backend, where you would be also sending the notification from. So this would be used in our app. Now let me, okay, so the first thing, okay, first I'm going to do the Android version, and the first thing we need to do is add two components. One is Android Cloud Messaging. Android Cloud Messaging Client. Okay, that's good, added. And another one is Azure Messaging. Okay, Azure Messaging is there. Okay, once these two components are added, let's go and create one constant file. This constant file can be in Xamarin Forms app because it will be used from both Android and iOS. So let's add a new file and constant. And I will need to define here three strings. I have it here already, so we don't waste time on that. And if you see here, there are three things: sender ID, connection string, and notification hub name. Sender ID will be used for Android. So on Firebase, here Firebase, we have sender ID. Need to copy that, paste it here. listen connection string, which we get from Azure, this one. So we copy that. Listen connection string and notification hub name is the name of the notification hub which we have here, which is notification monkey. So I just need to paste that notification monkey. Okay. Once this done, this constants will be used when we add the notifications. Coming back to Droid application, we need to add two files here. Let me first run this process. I will explain you this. But let's do it. So this is my project. Add files and Azure push notification browser, broadcast receiver and service. So broadcast receiver is, I mean, we generally know, would be able to, we will need to add some permissions for notification to work, and then this broadcast receiver will initiate this service, the push handler service. Push handler service is the one which we will be using. So okay, not really this one. Okay, I was referring to the wrong project, so maybe okay, that's not a problem. Okay, I need to change the name, notification monkey. Okay, so some few permissions and then the service, the name of the service, so push handler service. Push handler service, same thing I will do here. I'll explain it to you, but you don't want to keep on writing this code here, so let me just paste it. Okay. This is a service which would be running in background. It has to be a service, so that's why we have service tag here, because we want to receive this the notification even if the app is not running. And then there are few, and this is the service is, what do you call it, inherited from GCM service space, Google Cloud Messaging service space. And Google Cloud Messaging service biz has few methods which we need to override. So onRegistered will be called when we register, when the first step is done. So as a PPD. So when this step is done, the first step where you are going to send register the device and getting the device registration, when that is done, this event is going to be fired. The method is going to be called, and then what are we going to do is we will register it on the hub using the Azure messaging Azure messaging component which we had, that the library, and then the another message is the on message. On message is whenever we get a new push notification, this message will be called. This method will be called. We will extract the actual message from here and just say create notification. And create notification is going to create actual notification for the device, and then we'll just. And these are the few methods, but we are not doing anything here on that. particular thing. So by this, it should create a notification and push it. So let's try to test it. And by the way, I will be using the actual device to test it, because simulators are not a good idea to test the notifications. Okay, so my device is here. Let's see. Okay, it's building. So let's, okay, since this is building, let's go back and see what we do. So this was for the Android. The same way we'll need to be doing for iOS. iOS is a bit confusing. How many have you gone through the pain of installing the provision devices?
Anything Apple is just like,
yeah, it is. It is painful. It is confusing. I mean, yes. So. So for Apple, you need to first create a certificate for the push notification and then install that certificate. Only then you will be able to add it. Now, let me check. Okay, it looks like. Okay, so my app is running here. Now, let's see. Let's try to send some push notification from here. Ideally, we would have one backend, and then from that backend, we would send a message, call the Azure notification API to send a push notification. But here we are doing the test. So here on the notification hub, you have send test, and you can select the platform. So I will select Android, and it will send the message to notification to all the Android which are registered on it. So let me say send. So successfully send, but I don't see it here. Send. Okay. Is it connected to internet? Okay. We'll come back to that later. But let's see the iOS one first. So in iOS, like I said, you need to create first a certificate. Now, a little bit on certificate, it's always very confusing. So let me give you some background on the certificates. What actually I can do is, let me go here, how end-to-end encryption on WhatsApp works, okay? Hopefully, yeah, here is me, okay. So, generally, I mean, if you guys are not familiar with the certificate, what happens in certificate is that there are always two set of keys. One is the public key and one is private key. Now, the key is a mathematical two very large prime numbers, and those two prime numbers are usually in a way related, that if you do some calculation, like for example, if you do that calculation with one prime number and do the same calculation with another prime number, you will get back the original result. So there is this relation between these two primary and very large prime numbers. If you have one prime number, there's absolutely no way that you can trust the another prime number. So in easy terms, there are always two keys. One is a public key, one is a private key. If you encrypt anything with public key, you can only decrypt it using the private key. And if you encrypt something with a private key, you can only decrypt it using the public key. So in encryption, how it works is that the private key, you generate two keys, public key and private key are always generated in a pair. And private key, you keep private. So you do not share that private key with anyone. Public key is for everyone to share. Now, if let's say I have, I want to send something to someone. What I would do is I would encrypt that message with my private key, and then there would be some message which would be generated. That message can be this is how it goes. Okay, so let's say for example, if I Bob wants to send a message to Alice. Okay, now Bob has its own private and public key, and Alice have its own public and private key. Now, if I want to send a message to you, for example, I will use your public key, because public key is public, right? It can be available for anyone to look at it. So I will use your public key and encrypt that message with your public key. But nobody else would be able to decrypt it, because the only key which can unlock that message is your private key. And the private key is with you only, so it is private. So nobody would be able to read that message. When you receive it, you unlock it with your private key and the message is there. The same happens with the other way. When you want to send me the message, you would encrypt it using my public key. And then when it comes to me, I would unlock it or decrypt it using my private key, and then I would have it. This is how the encryption works, but we are not using encryption here. We are using code signing. So signatures are exactly opposite of encryption. In encryption, you always encrypt it using public key and decrypt it using private key. But in signature, you encrypt using private key and decrypt it using public key. It's a little bit confusing, but why would you do that? Let's say, for example, I want to say that this is something which I authorize, or this is something authentic coming from me. What I would do is I would encrypt it using my private key and push it to forward. Now, anyone who has my public key can decrypt it and see the content. That's fine. That is not the purpose. The purpose is that nobody would be able to encrypt it from my private key, because it's only me who has my private key. So only one person, it would be truly authenticated that this information is being signed by me only and not by anyone else. So in terms of application, when we submit the Apple code, it always signs, even if it is Android or Apple, it does signs with the pair of the public with the private key. Why it does that? No all other developers can sign your code and publish it on the server. So in that way, your code is protected. So that's the concept of public key and private key. So two keys need to be generated. Now, always the private keys and the public key, when they are generated, it has to be generated on your machine. If it is generated on the server and then you transfer it through a network, it is going to be compromised. It's risk to be compromised. So it is always better to generate it on your machine. Now, one way to generate it on the Mac is using keychain access. Go to keychain access, services, certificate assistant, yep, thank you. And request certificate from certificate authority. And I would enter my email address and I would say save it to desk. Now, this will create
certificate signing request.
Yeah, this is a request. This is this will generate the two keys, but it is not yet the certificate is not yet signed by Apple. So we will submit it to the Apple to sign it back. But before that, we'll create a request. So this is creating a request. I already have one request here. So let me just delete it. Okay, good. So the request has been created. Now coming back to Apple. Okay, so first what we need to do is create a new Apple ID. Okay. Create a new app ID. So go to the app ID, add new app ID. The name, I would say same, notification monkey, and bundle ID, which you remember I had there, com.alza, which is my company name, and then notification monkey. It's very important to have the same bundle ID as you have in the project, otherwise it won't work. And then here you need to select push notification and continue. So it gives you the confirmation, notification monkey, identification. Everything looks good. Okay, so I'll say register. Done. Notification monkey is registered. Okay. The next thing, I would go and create a certificate. So on certificate plus, certificate is Apple push notification service certificate, and then let's say continue. I'll select my app ID, which is notification monkey, and continue, and then continue, and then I would upload the CSR, the certificate request, which I have created earlier, which we created earlier and saved it on desktop. I will select that, open, and continue. Okay, so the certificate is ready. We'll download it and say done. Now I will need to add this, and this will be added in my, if I double click on Mac, it will add it to my certificates. Should be here. Yeah, notification monkey, and here is the key. So it's a private key with the public key certificate. Okay, that's great. One last thing which we need to do is let me just create a provision profile. I'll just say, and this is an iOS app development provision profile. It's not a notification profile. And I would select notification monkey, continue. I'll select one of the certificate and my iPhone, and same name here, notification monkey profile. Okay, and continue. I'll download that as well, and done. Okay, should be added. Now we need to move to, okay, one more thing. When we have added here in the keychain, this certificate of notification monkey which we created, this is a certificate which we need to upload it to the Azure notification enable to configure to the push notification. So what I would do here is export, and I would name it something, and this is the extension which you need to select, P12. The difference between the CR and P12 is that the CR only includes public key. So if you want to give it to someone else who want to encrypt the message and send it to you, you just select CR. But this one includes the public key and the private key. So never give some your P12 to anyone. It includes your private key as well. So save it. You need to give the password because it also keeps the private keys. So this is just a passphrase which protects your private keys. So you need to enter this password to open that file. I will just give a simple password here for now. And say OK. Allow. And this is the P12 file which we have here. So this we need to add it to Azure. So coming back to Azure.
You said you should never create your private key to anybody, but now you're giving it to Microsoft.
Of course, if you.
Very nice.
You give up on Microsoft anyways. You are using Visual Studio, Visual Studio Team Services, everything. So, yeah.
But then it's the private key to access the,
yeah, of course,
the Apple service.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah. So again, coming back to notification services, Apple, and here we need to upload the certificate, P12 file, the password. I need password to open the file, of course. So I would give the password which I created that. I'm selecting sandbox because we are not doing the live here. Okay, so the certificate thumbnail has been printed here. This looks like our application, Apple and Google have been configured for the notification services.
Just as a recall, you just took you 10 seconds to do the Google one, and it took probably like 10 or, yeah, 100 times more to make the Apple.
Sorry.
The Google push notification setup was like instant. You snap your finger.
Yeah.
Apple, you can just like snap your finger for a long time.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly, yeah.
Your
finger hurts a bit. Can
you put all those steps on the back?
You could, no, because you know. But it's always, it's a pros and cons. I mean, the Google is just using the app key, so anybody has your app key can literally send the notifications. But in terms of Apple, it's a public and private key, your complete P12 package. And even if they have the P12 package, they need the password to open that file. So, yeah, that's why it takes time.
So Apple is pure, Android is not.
Never conclude too easily. So coming back here on iOS. So on iOS, let me change this. Here again, we need to add a package or a component. The same component, Azure Messaging. Okay, and if you add the Azure Messaging, it shows here documentation that you need to add this few code in your app delegate file. When finished launching and then registered for remote notification and received remote notification. So these three matter you need to add. So we will do the same thing. Again, to save the time, I would copy from here. So let me just copy this. What I would do is before I launch my Xamarin Forms event, I would okay, we need to add here. Okay, sorry, my mistake. So this is the one from Azure Notification Hub. And there are two, I mean, there are different ways they keep on changing the API. So before version 8.0, there was different type of registering for notification. After 8.0, it is different API. And now even on the, after 10.0, iOS 10, is another API, which is a new API. I haven't added it, it still works, but there's a new API for that as well. Again, the same thing. We need to add this two functions, and others are just placeholders. Okay, so receive notification again when there will be new notification, this method will be called, and we will call the process notification with some the data which is received, and we'll extract. So this method is extracting that data. So if you go here, where is my Azure? Yeah, Azure. Coming back to test, send test, and if I select Apple, so it's a JSON which will be sent. So APS, and then inside that alert, and then your message, whatever message you had. And this is, I mean, you can configure however you want, but this is default. So basically what we are doing here is the same thing. We are extracting those keys, key value, and inside that we are extracting the message. And then one more thing which we are doing here is that if the app is running if the app is on front, if it is not in background, it is in front, then the notification will not be sent, will not be triggered. The platform will not trigger the notification, push notification, because the app is in foreground. If that is the case, we need to somehow notify the user that there was some notification in terms of any app notification way we do it. So for now here we will just display the alert view, and the other apps are just the functions which we are not doing anything here. Are just the function from the delegate, app delegate. Now doing this, I think yeah. It should be enough, it should work now. So let's try this. I will connect my phone. Again, the same thing, don't use the simulators. So I would use my device here. And let me just... Okay, so let me just so I have my device here, and let me okay, build. Okay, it's building. Okay, good. Select my phone and run it. Questions, by the way? Yeah.
Yeah, don't you have to set up the ID and everything for iOS? The app ID, like
the persons file?
Yeah, we have taken take care of that. You still have to do that. So when you are registering, let me go back. Here in App Delegate, we have.
No, I mean, in the project properties. Not your iOS, don't use the properties section, don't you have to
No, we have installed the provision profile already. You remember when we downloaded a provision profile and set up it up? But here you just need to take care is that... here you... not here. This is not Visual Studio. So here you just need to take care of the bundle ID, which you need to make sure that this is the same bundle ID.
On Azure, can you see your messages? Can you see the number of messages or statistics?
Yes, of course. You should get it in that in a second. There's a lot of statistics on Azure. So it will ask me for the permission first, allow. Okay, let's try to push notification from here. The send should work. Apple and send.
Yes, we do have yes, go on.
Do it. That's not good. Okay. For this reason, I have already pre-configured app, which is this. You know if this happens, right?
Only in this room.
Let me try this one. So this is the exactly same one. This is the app which I was copying the code from here. Let's try from this one. The last time I know this was working, but let's try again.
It works on my machine, by the way.
Okay. Yeah, you got it. So this we already handled the in-app notifications because the app is in foreground. So when we go in background, we send it again, and it should appear there. Yeah, it's there. Okay. But you can also use the tags. We have not used the tags. We are just sending. But we can use the tags to identify what kind of context you are sending those notifications to, and then depending on that you can customize your experience. And there are a lot of different other tools which you can use here. When we selected the tier, the free tier doesn't have that, but if you select the standard one, you get the rich telemetry of all the analytics, and there's a lot of things which you can do from there. You can schedule the push in later state, multi-tenancy, and just look at the price difference. It's from $10 to direct $200.
Microsoft knows you've got no sensor.
Microsoft is new Google. So that's how we can use the notification on the Azure.
So send it to my phone would be easy, right?
Windows Phone.
I cannot demonstrate the Windows here because I'm using the Mac, and I don't use the parallels. It's the same concept. Which you need to do the registration and then connect it to the Azure and then send it. So the same thing. Yep. Any questions?
How do we get the wine?
We need to go to the bar.
You want to get rid of it?
Well, I don't want to get rid of it. I'll happily drink it, but it's just like it was something for the people that were just tasting at the end. So,
there's still plenty to share.
I'm going to have
a lot of people.
we don't have
But organized, just like somebody needs to just to find something right to do.
Okay, cool. Then that's it.
I think everybody will do this for mental line.
I have a question, simple question. All right. Wait, Microsoft feeling this will be Microsoft question. Okay,
yeah. Are you done?
Yeah, and then any questions if you don't have, then yeah, done. Okay. Thank you.